Hi, everybody, and welcome to Ewe University. I'm Dr. Kelly. So this is my first video after our spring break here at Ewe University. It's been a good few weeks. I got a lot done, and I found some tulips at my local flower shop. They've been really low on cut flowers lately, so I was happy to see that they had some tulips in stock, because I haven't seen any tulips there for over a month. These are pink and red ones, and they are just starting to open up today. So there's our pretty flowers for the day. Over the past couple of weeks, my mailbox has been filled with happy cards and postcards. So thank you to all of you who sent these. I love them. I love going to my mailbox and finding all this happiness. Have you guys seen the pretty stamps that came out in March? Some of the ones that I got are the Oscar de la Renta stamps. These are a sheet of 10 stamps that are kind of a larger size, and they picture some of the gowns and fabrics that he designed. And if you get these sheets of stamps, don't forget, like I almost did, that there is one additional stamp with at the top of the sheet with a picture of Oscar de la Renta himself on it. So it's kind of weird that there are 11 stamps on each sheet, but they really are pretty. The other stamps that I like that came out in March are the JFK stamps. You can see I've already used some of them. These have John F. Kennedy's picture on them, and these are really nice as well. So these are some stamps that I like that I picked up at the post office a few weeks ago. Okay, let me talk about knitting for a few minutes. Well, I cast on my first new project for this year in March. Up until that time, I had been just finishing old projects, but I wanted to make a pair of knee socks for a secret recipient. And I've never knit knee socks. I've always knit regular, like, crew socks and or shorty socks. And so I'm just making this pattern up as I go. Now, I prefer making socks top down. So in this case, I am estimating how long to make the leg before I start the heel. I'm doing these two at a time on 9-inch circular needles. The tricky part is to make sure to have enough yarn to finish the foot. Now at this point, I have both of the legs done and they are 10 inches long. And now I need to put the heel in. The yarn I'm using for this project is KnitPicks Felici in the toucan colorway. This knits up into stripes of blue, yellow, and purple. The stripes are pretty and fun. Now you'll notice that these socks don't match exactly. I mean, the stripes don't start in the exact same spot on the color repeats. But to me, that's fine. It really doesn't bother me. And I think it's kind of hip to have unmatching socks. So yeah, I would say these socks are about at the end of sophomore status, and I am motivated to get them done and not let them sit and languish for a long time. The other projects that I've worked on and that graduated off the needles are a couple of hats that I made to donate as chemo caps. This is one of my favorite go-to patterns for making chemo hats, and it is called the Lace Edge Women's Hat by Julie Hentz. It's a free pattern on Ravelry, and it comes with instructions for three different sizes. It calls for DK weight yarn and a US size 6 needle, which is a 4.25 millimeter. These hats are very stretchy, and I actually use the old Norwegian cast on, or it's also called the German twisted cast on. It's similar to the long tail cast on, but it has an extra little twist, which makes it even more stretchy. I would definitely use a stretchy cast on for this pattern. I knit the small hat size in the turquoise yarn and a medium size in the pink yarn. But honestly, when I put them together, they don't look that different. There's only a 4-stitch difference in the size of the hat, so it's not that big of a difference between the small and the medium sizes. The hat is mostly stockinette stitch with this little lace band around the bottom. And I don't know if you can see, but the lace causes a little scalloped look to the edge of the hat, and I think that gives it a pretty detail. The yarn I used is Yarn Art Jeans, and it is a cotton nylon blend that is machine washable. It is DK weight, pretty tightly spun, but it's still nice, lightweight, and it shows the lacy edging well. It's got really good stitch definition too. It's weird that the ball band doesn't say the name of the colorway or a color number. I picked up this yarn in Romania a few years ago, so I wasn't even sure if you could get it here, but I looked it up and you can, and it's only $1.99 a ball. So it's really reasonably priced. And I'm pretty sure I can get 2 hats out of 1 ball of yarn. This is what's left over from this hat, and so I'm pretty sure there's enough to make another small size hat out of this. Anyway, I've just been in the mood for making these little hats to donate. A few months ago, I knit a stack of these and donated them for chemo caps, and they were snapped up really fast. The hats that I've seen in the basket in the doctor's office were not all that attractive, so I really wanted to make something that is special and pretty. And I do like this lace pattern a lot. So if you're looking for a quick and easy project, this is a good one. And again, that is the Lace Edged Women's Hat by Julie Hentz. And I'll include links to the yarn and the pattern in the description box below. Okay, we are going right into the classroom today because I have a lot of information to bring you. Today's topic is sock blanks. And in case you're not familiar, a sock blank is a rectangular piece of knitted fabric. It's basically a long strip of stockinette stitch made out of fingering weight yarn. You unravel one end of the sock blank to use the yarn to make a pair of socks. Or I suppose you could make something else with it, like a shawl or something, but most people make socks out of it. And you might wonder, why would someone want to unravel a sock blank to knit socks out of the yarn as opposed to knitting with a yarn in a skein or a ball? But a lot of people seem to like sock blanks because they are portable. You can just fold it up and stick it in your project bag. And it's convenient because you don't have to wind the yarn into a ball before you use it like you would with a hank of yarn. But the original reason that sock blanks were created was for dyeing yarn. With a sock blank, it's a lot easier to dye something like self-striping or patterns in the yarn that will appear when the sock is knit up. Dyeing a sock blank makes it way easier to produce the longer color repeats that are required for self-striping yarn, as opposed to using something like a warping board or a warping mill, which are total pains in the neck. So I was curious as to when sock blanks started to be used. How many years back have they been a thing? Well, it seems that sock blanks were invented about 20 years ago by Nancy Roberts, a knitter in San Francisco. It was one of those cases where she put 2 things together that had never been connected, and it just took off. At the time, Nancy was an experienced hand knitter who was also interested in machine knitting. In 1995, she saw an article by Rebecca Younger in Threads magazine entitled "Subtle Color Shading for Patterned Knits." And this article talked about how you could paint a knit fabric and then unravel it and re-knit it for smooth color transitions. And when Nancy read that article, she thought, hey, you could probably make a knitted fabric square with a knitting machine and then do the dyeing and then unravel it and re-knit it. Well, as inspired as she was, she didn't get around to buying a knitting machine until about 8 years later. She started experimenting with this process, creating quick machine knit stockinette fabric for multicolor dyeing. She actually wrote an article about her technique in Spinoff magazine that was published in 2006. Now, around that same time, 2005, 2006, Nancy started selling what she was calling sock blanks at Stitches West. So anyway, sock blanks just took off from there, and they just seem to be getting more and more popular over the past few years as dyers are creating beautiful, artistic sock blanks. Now, knitting with sock blanks is a little bit different than knitting from a regular skein of yarn, mainly because the yarn is kinky. I mean, you are unraveling a knitted fabric, so the yarn is kinked up from being knit previously. Now, for myself, I don't mind that at all. I actually find that knitting socks with the kinky yarn makes them a little squishier and feel softer and more spongy than when I knit with regular yarn. But if you're a person who doesn't like the kinky yarn, you can always unravel the whole sock blank and put the yarn into a hank or a big circle and then soak the yarn and hang it to dry. And that usually relaxes the kinks a bit. Now, there are several places that you can buy undyed sock blanks in case you're interested in getting a hold of some to dye for yourself. They are a little pricey for undyed yarn, which is why they're often more expensive than a skein of yarn when you're buying from a dyer. You can get them from KnitPicks for $20 a piece. Dharma Trading Company has them for $18.55 each, but when you buy more, you get discounts. And then you can buy sock blanks from Wool to Dye For, which is a popular wholesale company that a lot of dyers buy from. But you can still buy from them if you don't have a business. You just don't get the wholesale prices. But with Wool to Dye For, you have to buy packages of 5 sock blanks, which are around $70. But that breaks down to only $14 each, which is the least expensive option. So yeah, if you're interested in purchasing your own undyed sock blanks to paint or dye yourself, those are some options. But if you're like me, you might be wondering, is there a way that I could make my own sock blanks? And this is something that I've thought about for the past year or so. And one of my good friends, who is a knitter, Anne, has recently started doing some machine knitting on flatbed knitting machines. And we had talked about making sock blanks months ago. And so while I was on spring break, I made arrangements to go visit her to talk about not only making sock blanks, but also just generally about knitting with flatbed knitting machines. Now, Anne is my friend who hosts our semi-annual knitting retreat at her barn, and that is the location where we filmed the upcoming footage. Now, at this barn, she has flat knitting machines, circular knitting machines, sewing machines, yarn, fabric, pretty much everything a crafter could want in a spacious and beautiful studio. So first we sat down and I asked her about machine knitting and how she got into doing that. Okay, so can you tell us just a little bit about how you got interested in the flatbed knitting?
Well, I knit on a circular sock machine, and I realized that I couldn't do everything I wanted to do on that machine, and it got me thinking that I knew that there were flat machines out there. So I started searching around online and just trying to gather information to figure out exactly what it was that I wanted. And I came across a class that was going to be at Vogue Knitting in Chicago. And I thought, well, this is the perfect opportunity for me to experiment a little bit, not have to put any money out for a machine, and actually get my hands on a machine. So I went up and took that class from Susan Gugliami. I'm not going to say it right. And she was a wonderful teacher. She's been teaching for that Singer Silver Reed company for years. She made the class fun. She made it informative, hands-on. It was great. I was hooked.
So the class was learning on a plastic machine.
It was. And they're wonderful machines. They're great.
The ones that we're going to look at today are metal.
They're metal machines. So they are definitely a step up from the plastic machines. They have punch cards. They have automatic patterning in because of those punch cards. They glide a lot easier. They're definitely more heavy duty. They have both of them that I have the ribbers with them. So there's lots of more things that I can do with those. I've seen many people with a plastic machine make beautiful sweaters, beautiful hats, mittens, scarves, toys, socks, you know, all kinds of things with those machines. And I don't ever want to say that there isn't a place for them. For me, I enjoy the metal machines, mm-hmm. but I did also have to pay quite a bit more for them.
What's the price differential?
Well, I think that the plastic machines right now are in the $440 or $50 range, possibly. That would be a new machine, and that would also include lessons, which would be really helpful if you buy from a dealer.
What would your advice be if someone were interested in starting to use a flatbed knitting machine or just interested in trying it out?
Well, first of all, I would get online and see if you can find a dealer close by you. So you can at least go see what is out there that's new. First of all, become educated. That's what I did. I got online, I compared, I got on Ravelry. There's three different groups on Ravelry. One is Machine Knitting Sales, I think it's called. The other one is Machine Knitting. It will cover all gauges of knitting machines. Then there's a mid-gauge group. I'm sure that there are more groups than that. Those are the three that I belong to. So I started asking questions. And there's pages that they have on there that talk about buying a new versus used machine. So there's all kinds of things that you can do. But I think the main thing is become educated. Figure out what it is you want. I at first thought that the most important thing was that I had all of the same brand of machines so that when I went from machine to machine, they would be similar. Actually, that's every single one of my machines is a different brand, and it hasn't made a difference to me at all. To other people, it might. I just know that when I get ready to switch to a different machine, sometimes I just have to pull that book out for a minute and familiarize myself again with the buttons. So that is what works for me.
The next thing we did was figure out how to create a sock blank. To do this, Anne got out her smaller gauge flat knitting machine, which uses fingering weight yarn. I had brought my own cone of yarn, this cone, because working from a cone is a lot easier with knitting machines than working from a skein of yarn. Now this particular cone is an 80-20 merino nylon blend, and it is 400 yards per 100 grams. I also brought along a sock blank that I had purchased so that we could kind of fashion the sock blank we made after the manufactured one. We counted the number of stitches to see how wide it was, and this was about 80 stitches wide. So we set up the knitting machine for 80 stitches. And then we weighed the cone on a scale so we could see how much we were starting with. The goal was 100 gram sock blank because that would be 400 yards, which is the normal amount of yarn for both a skein of yarn and a sock blank. And that will usually be enough to make two socks. So whatever the weight of the yarn cone was originally, we would just keep knitting the sock blank on the machine until the cone was 100 grams lighter. Now, we decided to do a single-stranded sock blank as opposed to a double-stranded one. Some sock blanks are constructed out of just one strand of yarn, while other sock blanks are constructed out of two strands.
The double
sock blanks made out of two strands would be for those people who like to knit two socks at a time and want to make sure that the socks match exactly. For myself, I find the double-stranded ones to be a little harder to handle because you have to really keep track of the yarn as you unravel it, and it can get tangled. I'm perfectly happy using a single strand sock blank. So that's what we created, and I thought it would just be easier for the first one we made anyway. So let's go to Anne's studio and we'll find out a little bit about this particular knitting machine and then watch her set up the machine and make a sock blank.
So this is a studio model 360 flatbed knitting machine. It's a standard gauge, generally uses fingering weight yarn, something lighter weight. You could use lace if you wanted to on it. This is the actual carriage that goes back and forth across the needles and actually makes them knit. The needles are in the base here. I don't know all the specific terms, but I'll do the best that I can. This is the yarn mast. This is the yarn topper, and it will tension the yarn as it comes down. We've got some settings here. I generally leave it right in the center there at 3. Then it will come down into this area, and this is where you can set your different tensions on this dial. And then these do different things. We've got Fair Isle lace. This is just a regular stitch. I think this is a slip stitch, and that's tuck. And you do some other things with some buttons and that type of thing to get a different design. There's also a punch card reader here. So the punch card fits in there, and it will, the machine can memorize this design, and then as it goes across, it will select needles, and those needles will knit or not knit, depending on the design that you have. Many different designs that you can get on these punch cards. You can punch your own if you'd like to. Anyway, that would be the main parts of the machine. To go from the center of 0, we're going to choose to do 80 stitches each side, but we're just going to start out with every other. Let's see here. Let's go to, we'll go to there. And this is an every other needle selector, just, you know, plastic tool. And then I'm going to choose that one. There we go. Even if we're off by one stitch, it won't matter. So then we will come up here.
So we're taking waste yarn.
Yep, waste yarn, and we're going to thread this. Okay, gonna load it into the machine, close that. We're set on a medium tension of 5. And now I'm going to take this and I'm gonna run it across here. And if you can see that every other needle was chosen there. Okay, and again, I've gotta grab a couple of things. I'm gonna put the comb on here.
And that's like a weight?
I can use it for a weight, yes. So now it can be the weight, and I may not need much more than that, but I'm gonna go ahead and throw these on there.
And that's gonna be for pulling down the,
yes,
the finished sock blank in this case.
Right. It helps to form the stitches. Okay, so I'm just going to run this across here. Whoops, I forgot to bring the rest of the needles out, but that's all right. We'll bring them out now.
Now, why did you start with only half of them?
It's a good cast on. It's an easy cast on.
Oh, I see.
Because this is all going to get taken off of here anyway. I think this is not bad.
Yeah.
It looks good.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I'm gonna go back to the right and I'm going to cut that. Okay.
Now, how do we attach that?
We're not going to.
Oh, you just...
We're just gonna hold on. I like to just hold on to both ends right down here.
Okay.
And then I'm just gonna start knitting because we're going to want to release this from the waist yarn.
This is like a...
You may want to steam it before you do that.
So this is like a provisional cast on type thing.
It is. It is. So now we're just gonna come across. And now we're doing the white stitches right onto the other stitches. Mm-hmm. So let's try to keep track of how many rows we're gonna do. So we're gonna go back to zero. So we're 0, 0, 0. And each time this goes across, it's going to trip that counter and we'll be able to keep track of our rows. And one row this way, one row that way, it'll count them. That you want to tuck it in and not have them try to knit from here. You want to knit from this end. So now what we're going to do is I'm going to cut it. I'm going to switch to a waist yarn. And I'm going to do, I don't know, 10 rows.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
There we go. Mm-hmm. Okay, so now there's no yarn in here. So we're going to just pass this across and it will let these go. And I'm going to hold just a little bit of tension here. And there it comes right off.
Making that sock blank took 10 to 15 minutes. Not much time at all. Okay, so after we made the sock blank, we went over to another one of her flatbed knitting machines to talk about that one. And this is a bigger machine that uses worsted weight yarn. So Anne's gonna tell us a little bit about the larger machine, how it works, and what kind of things she knits on it.
Okay, so let's introduce this machine.
This is a Brother KH260 bulky flatbed knitting machine with ribber. I've made many hats on this machine, and I've made mittens, I've made teddy bears, I've, you know, made all kinds of things, but one of the things that you can make on there is a sweater. So I have a sleeve here, the other sleeve, well, I guess I do have one sleeve in. So I've put that sleeve in. I still have, it looks like, the underarm seam to do here. I've gotten the front and the back together. That's something fun to do.
Now I noticed this machine is not, it doesn't have a flat surface like the other one. I mean, it's kind of angled.
This stand will allow you to tilt this up, and when you're using the main knitting bed with the ribber bed,
You need, this down here is the riverbed.
This is the riverbed. You need your project to hang straight down from the joint, from where those two cross over. So this is set up to get started with a project. If I run this across, you'll see these move and see how they're pulling in and they're coming across here. Each of them is going, they're alternating. Now, it brought, by me doing that, it brought them all into what's considered upper working position. So these are still gonna work. These down here are out of work, the lower ones, same thing up here. The ones that are closer out here, these are in upper working position, and these are out of work. Let me show how this works. This will actually move down and allow you to just knit. And then you would move this out of the way, you would bring all of these down and out of work, and then you would just be working up here to finish your sweater.
What's the story behind this one?
When I was over taking a lesson from Carol Foster in Columbus Junction, Iowa, I mentioned to her that I was really interested. I had a lot of worsted weight yarn, and I was really interested in making hats, making some sweaters on a knitting machine, and did she know of anybody who had one? And so she put me in touch with a woman who had one for sale.
Now, about the punch cards, did it come with punch cards, or do you buy them separately?
It actually comes with a couple of sets of punch cards, but then you can buy some separately. You can buy some on Etsy that come from Russia. And then you can also punch your own. So if you find a design that is, these are 24 stitch repeats. So if you find a design that's a 24 stitch repeat, you can actually take a punch, you can take a blank card.
So they make the blank cards?
They do, they make the blank cards and they make a punch, a hand punch. There's a couple different styles of punches that you can use.
So you could go to your stitch dictionary, mm-hmm. and if there's a pattern in there that you love, you can make your own.
Or totally design it yourself.
Right.
You can make up whatever design that you'd like. There's some books out there that have the design in there and they expect you to just punch your own card and just do that. I've done a little bit of that. I punched a card for a baby Afghan that I have right over here. And this was done on the original machine that I showed you on the standard gauge. But this baby Afghan, I think this is the prettiest side. I punched the card for that. And it's a tuck pattern. So one of the things about a tuck pattern is it will lay flat. It will not roll the same way that stockinette rolls. And then I am in the process, we'll see where it is, of putting a worm edge on it to give it just a little bit of an edge design. And this is Diana Sullivan has YouTube videos out there and she teaches how to do this. So I did a bit of it and then I needed to take it off my machine. So now I'll just hang those stitches back and I can start over again and continue on.
So as you saw and heard, Anne has knit a lot of different projects on this machine, including hats, mittens, sweaters, and even that intricate baby blanket. This is a picture of a teddy bear that she knit with that machine. As you can see, these knitting machines are very versatile and can be used to make a large variety of projects. I hope you enjoyed finding out about flat knitting machines and how they work. And I also wanted to say a big thank you to my friend Anne for telling us about flatbed knitting machines and showing us how we can create our own sock blanks with them. Now, let's go back to the sock blank. So when I got it home, I wanted to get it ready to knit from. And this is the one that we made. So to get it ready to knit from basically involved removing the waste yarn from the beginning and the end of the sock blank. I started with the waste yarn at the end of the blank because that's the easiest to remove. The first thing you want to do is steam the end of the sock blank so that the knitting lays flat, and the steam also kind of plumps up the stitches. I had my iron set on high, but I really didn't press down on the knitted fabric. I just kind of lightly touched it or hovered above it with the iron. And I pressed the steam button so that mostly it was steaming the fabric. And you can see that really worked to make it lay flat. To remove the waste yarn from the end of the sock blank, all you have to do is unravel it. Once you get to the blank itself, just stop unraveling. Now, for the beginning of the sock blank, it's a little more difficult to remove the waste yarn. You can tell the beginning because it has a different edge. Anne used a looser cast-on edge, so you can see that the loops are bigger, and you know at a glance that's the top of the sock blank. So if you're making your own, I would totally recommend that you do this so it's easy to tell which end is the top and which is the bottom. Again, you want to steam the end of the sock blank to flatten out the knitting and plump up the stitches. Now, this end is not so easy because you can't just unravel it because it's the beginning of the knitting. So the simplest thing to do is take a scissors and cut the waste yarn close to the actual sock blank, but be sure you don't cut into the blank itself. Once the waste yarn is cut, you can pull it away from the sock blank, but be warned, it can get a little messy. The key here for the beginning edge of the sock blank is to be sure to pull the end of the yarn through the first loop so that it creates a lock stitch. This is another reason why you want to steam the fabric to plump up the stitches so you can more clearly see the loops and draw that yarn end through. That way, when you go to knit with the sock blank, if you pull on this end, it will clearly not unravel, so you'll know this is not the end to knit from. The other end will easily unravel. Anyway, now that all the waste yarn is removed, it is ready to be dyed and then unraveled and re-knit. So there you go. That is the process of making a sock blank. And in an upcoming episode, I'll be talking about dyeing sock blanks, so keep an eye out for that future video. Well, that brings us to the end of today's show. I hope you've enjoyed learning about flatbed machine knitting and using one of these knitting machines to make sock blanks. So have you ever used a sock blank before? What do you think? Do you like knitting with sock blanks? Does the kinky yarn bother you? Have you ever tried making your own sock blank? And how did you do it? Did you use a flatbed knitting machine or some other technique? I'm always interested in your experiences with the different topics that I talk about in the show. Let me know your sock blank experiences in the comment section below. Also, feel free to comment if you have any questions about today's show, or if you have an idea for what you'd like to see on future episodes, or if you'd like to see a product tested. I'd love to hear from you. Leave your suggestions in the comment section below. Thank you so much for spending some time with me today, and I'll see you in the next video. Next week, I'm going to be talking about the softest yarn in the universe. I don't think you want to miss that, so I hope you'll join me next time. In the meantime, have a sparkly week.